Good evening, Boston Unity Group. Welcome to 2021. We made it. We've made it to another year, and we have got some great content lined up for you this year. It's January. There's snow on the ground. We're still stuck at home, but it's okay. We're here, and we've got you some great talks. First of all, we have a couple of announcements. There's been a whole heap of presentations and meetups for the Boston area recently. If you haven't seen any of them, I highly encourage you to come on and join us in the Boston Game Dev Slack, where you can find out about all of these things. There is also the Boston Game Dev Meetup, which actually kind of lists a whole heap of other organized events that go on. We had last night was the Boston Postmortem, and there's also been a load of bit show shows from the Boston Indies, which have been fantastic. They are so much fun to listen to, so I would highly recommend all of those to you all. The link to the Slack is in Twitch chat now, so you can save that to your bookmarks. Join the Slack and come join the party. This weekend is Global Game Jam 2021, starting today actually until I think the end of Sunday. Theme is, I believe, Lost and Found. So get your thinking hats on. Ashley from Unity posted a really great little brief video on some things that Unity has that might help you fast track some kind of a game dev process over the next 3-4 days of hectic coding. So if you're interested, you should check out her tweet. Just put that into the chat for you all now. I thought that was a really good overview of some of the features that Unity has these days. Not all of them require you to sit there and type code, so really useful stuff. The next Boston Indies is in March. We think it's on the 15th. They're going to have lightning talks, so if anybody has a short presentation they want to give on anything cool game development wise, you can hit them up. If you have a longer presentation that you might want to do about Unity's specific kind of content, you can always talk to us, because we're always on the lookout for new presenters, and we would love to host you. So feel free to drop us a note. So, Graham, anything else I missed? I'm trying to remember. I mean,
you just nailed it. Like, I had a bunch of stuff, but you just said it all, so I don't
Damn!
Know.
Like, I came prepared for once.
Well, that makes one of us.
Notepad. I have notepad window open. That's how prepared we are these days, kids. Nice. So, Elliot cannot make it tonight. We'll say hi to Elliot from afar. Elliot is crunching hard on a project he is working on for the Sundance Festival. So, hi, Elliot. Sorry you can't make it. Okay, tonight, let me introduce Oren to you. Oren, joining us all the way from Israel. Oren is an outstanding developer who has worked on a really cool exporter for Unity that he is going to tell you all about, that you can take advantage of for doing WebXR. It sounds awesome. So, Oren, welcome to Boston Unity Group. It's nice to you've come all this way. We're really delighted to have you here tonight. Over to you, please, and take it away.
Yeah, I think I'll just share the screen. Yeah. Well, okay, so, WebXR for game jams, for prototyping. So I'm really excited about this talk. You probably see this. So today or tonight, we'll talk about WebXR for game jams. Before we begin, some questions for the audience, like, where are you all from? Anyone from Boston, not from Boston? You can comment in the Twitch.
Oh, we always have that satellite delay. Oh, wow.
Yeah. Oh, Taiwan. Yeah, nice. Okay. So anyone already been to one of my WebXR talks or watched one of my videos in the past? You can comment plus one on the chat.
I think you might have a bunch of first timers here.
Yeah. So the start of my talk will be similar to the previous talk, but this time I'll run quickly over what is WebXR, and most of the Unity parts will be shown in the editor instead of some theoretical stuff. So more hands-on. So who am I? Why am I talking here about WebXR and Unity? So I'm a game and software developer. I'm co-admin at the Israel Unity Developers Facebook and Meetup groups. By day, I work at Resonai, where I'm part of a team that works on Vera, which is an AR platform that transforms physical spaces into intelligent digital environments. I worked there on the Unity SDK and on some AR experiences and demos. This one is from CES. It's something that another company developed using our platform. This is me in the office shouting that I'm Dumbledore while I'm turning off lights using AR, like the Illuminator, all the Harry Potter fans. And there are some indoor navigation and stuff like that. And recently, in the past year, like in my spare time, I'm working on WebXR Export, which is a Unity XR package that allows building WebXR experiences using Unity. I actually started to work on porting some of my old games from Gear VR to WebXR. And yeah, so as you can see, it works on in VR in the browser, and there's also AR in the phone. And I actually started to work on the WebXR Export on the last Global Game Jam. So agenda, what we have in the agenda today. WebXR on the web, WebXR in Unity, and WebXR Export we will prototype in Unity. Things that I want you to take from this talk is what is WebXR, pros and cons, and some tips. What capabilities of WebXR are supported in Unity? And how to use different features on WebXR Export in Unity. And I try to read the comments in the chat, but I'm too focused on the talk. So you can ask in the chat some questions while I talk, and Christine or Graham will ask me, and I'll answer if I can. So let's start with WebXR on the web. So who already worked on WebXR experience in the past. Plus one, minus one.
I've never touched WebXR at all. I'm looking forward to this talk.
Yeah, same.
Oh, I see that people actually... Okay, I guess some people here from the Discord, the WebXR Discord. okay, so WebXR... I guess that some of you in the past heard about WebVR or heard about web libraries like ARJS. So those are not part of WebXR. The WebXR API, is a web standard that allows launching VR and AR experiences from web pages on supported devices and browsers. In the past, there was the WebVR API, which is now deprecated. It's kind of merged into the WebXR API. ARJS and other computer vision libraries are usually based on other web APIs for webcam streams. The WebXR API uses the native XR capabilities of the device. So on desktop, it will use OpenXR to run VR experiences on connected headsets. On standalone headsets like Oculus Quest or HoloLens 2, it will use the device native APIs or sometimes will use also OpenXR. In HoloLens, it's supported using OpenXR. There's the Firefox Reality app there, and soon Edge will also support WebXR there. On Android, it will use the AR Core or the Cardboard API for AR or VR. On iOS, there's no official support of Apple to WebXR. There's the Mozilla WebXR Viewer app, which is now deprecated, but it's still on the store, so you can test it there. In this talk, I'll focus more on the VR capabilities of WebXR as it's more matured and it's working more better on Unity. And this talk is on Unity. but a few important notes about WebXR. It requires secure connection. So pages should run on HTTPS server and not HTTP. Unity, usually the build and run of WebGL opens HTTP server. So if you'll just click build and run and you try to run your experiences, it won't work. So you need a local server that supports HTTPS. We'll talk about it later. and WebXR is based on promises for C# developers. It's like async methods and actions. So some features and data that you request may take some time to return. It won't be immediate. WebXR is an exciting API. You can create with it new types of experiences. You are not dependent on app stores. You can run the same experience on multiple devices, and some browsers and devices are supporting progressive web apps, which let your users install a shortcut icon to your web page on the user's desktop or home screen, and combine it with some cache management for offline mode. And it's like the user actually installed your game. Like I have here on my desktop a game that I'm working on. And if I'll put this headset, and I hope that I don't need to recalibrate. So this is a web page. And in this web page, I can click on VR. Oh, and you will see nothing because I need to share the screen. I knew I forgot something. Okay. And phone is stuck.
It disappeared the second you started it. Oh, there it is. Oh.
Something stopped.
We are pushing the boundaries of technology at this point. And every time you put the headset on, the window disappears off our screen. It knows. There it is.
Every time I put the headset on, something doesn't work.
It did. The screen disappears for us. She's. It hides when you can't see it, which is very mean of it.
Okay. So, yeah.
There it is.
Well, it seems that I won't be able to share the screen on WebVR.
Live demos.
Live demos, yeah.
But in Unity it will work, so it's okay.
That's okay, we have fallback plans for this very reason.
Forget about WebXR, it doesn't work. Yeah.
Not over Zoom. I think that's the problem. We are.
Yeah, okay. And my Chrome just crashed.
Of course it did.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So. Let's open stuff again. Yeah. Okay, live demos.
We love them.
Yeah. Okay, so I'm here again in the chat. I see already comments again. So who already worked? Okay, so. Who already worked on XR in Unity, not WebXR, just XR in Unity, like AR or VR?
I've spent a lot of time fighting with Quest and with HoloLens in recent days.
And some people in the chat already wrote that they worked with WebXR in Unity.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So I'll start with a warning that you probably can understand already. So unless you know exactly what you are doing, I won't recommend using Unity for commercial I won't recommend using Unity for commercial WebXR experiences. There are lots of advantages of using Unity for WebXR development, like a familiar workflow, a great editor, using existing add-ons and assets that are made for other platforms. And I think that it's great for educational projects, demos, or experiments, prototyping, game jams, like the global game jam that we'll have tomorrow, and hackathons. But there is no official Unity support, and the current WebXR exporters are still work in progress. But hey, we are here to talk about WebXR and Unity for prototyping and game jams and hackathons, so it's okay. So there are three Unity WebXR exporters that I know of, and they have some similarities. I'm going to talk about WebXR Export, which is the exporter that I'm working on. Most of the concepts are the same in the other exporters. For starters, to understand how WebXR in Unity works, let's start with WebGL. WebGL is a web standard that tells the browser how to draw graphics on a canvas HTML element. There are two versions for WebGL. WebGL 1 is very similar to OpenGL ES 2, while WebGL 2 is very similar to OpenGL ES 3. Unity has support for WebGL, which builds Unity using the Emscripten compiler and the SDL port for Emscripten. SDL is Simple Direct Media Layer. It's a library for graphics and other media. It first translates the C# and .NET code to C++, and then compiled C++ code to WebAssembly using Emscripten. Unity uses the SDL port to call WebGL methods. SDL and Emscripten and the SDL port for Emscripten, and they are all open source. So you can dig into them and understand how part of Unity works. So it really helped when working on WebXR Export. The main files that you get when building a project using Unity WebGL are a data file, framework, JavaScript file, and the WebAssembly or WASM file. The WASM file communicates or interacts with the page using the JavaScript framework file. So that's enough talk about WebGL, and let's talk about WebXR in Unity. So similar to how the WASM WebAssembly code interacts with the WebGL API using SDL, we need the WASM code to interact with the WebXR API. For that, the exporters add a layer of code both in C# and JavaScript. They add components for the different abilities of WebXR, like a camera component and a controller component. And I think that was enough to talk without opening the Unity editor. So let's open it. First, some links here. In the WebXR Export GitHub, there's some how to start and some guidelines. And I'll share with you link to the project that I'm now will show. So those of you who want can see the demo while I'm showing it in the editor. Okay. So I'll run it in the editor. This time it should work. So we have here some canvas UI, and we have like a teleporter, and we have this robot. The art here is by Kenny. I guess most of the Unity developers know him from his free assets. And we have some. Yeah, so that's the demo. There are some secret pizzas, so I wonder if some of you will find all the pizzas in the scene. And let's see what we have in the project. I didn't hear anything if you talked while I was in the VR. So
that's okay. There wasn't any talking whilst you were in there, but we did see the demo, and it looked good from what I could see, at least.
Okay. Mm-hmm. At least that worked. Okay. Let's start with how you start out in adding the WebXR package to your project. There's the package manager. There are number of packages that add support for WebXR. The main one is the WebXR Export, which has the base components like the camera, the XR subsystems, and stuff like that. After that, you have the WebXR interactions that add some layers over the components of WebXR exports, like the grab component and stuff like that. There's also a sample scene that some of you might be familiar with. And there's another package which calls the input profiles loader, which adds support. One of the cool things in WebXR is that each device has a profile name. And the profile name let the developer understand what capabilities has to the controllers. I don't know if you were able to see those with the Zoom background.
I can see them. Yeah, they're Oculus Touch style controllers. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So, you know, you are working on different devices. So the input profile loader helps you load models of the device you are using right now. So if a user will run it on Quest 2, he will see the Quest 2 touch controllers. And in Quest 1, he will see the old touch controllers like I have here. If he's running on desktop and he's using Windows Mixed Reality, you will see a model of the Windows Mixed Reality controller, and et cetera, et cetera. And only for this demo, I made a Git repository using the VR teleporter by iGemin. If you developed for XR like 4 years ago, you remember it from the days of the gaze input system and other old legacy code that are used for the DK2 or for cardboard and stuff like that. let's see. Once we added the WebXR export to our project, and I'll show one and how we do it. We using Open UPM for the package, so you can go to the getting started. So there's Open UPM. I guess some Unity developers are familiar with it. So you can get it here, or you can set the Open UPM scope in the editor and adding the package from the manifest file. I don't think that I need right now to enter into more details, but I can show later how it's done on the manifest. Then after we added the package, the WebXR export is partially based on the XR plugin management. Unity don't have support. Unity's XR SDK don't have support for WebGL, but the subsystems do work with WebGL. So we try to make WebXR export more similar to working with other XR plugins like the Oculus and the other plugins, but we still had to use our own components for camera and controllers. I need to say thanks to Needle Tools, Felix and Marcel, that really helped. They made the package actually work with the parts that do support WebGL in the XR SDK. So to enable the WebXR export, you need to go to the project settings, XR plugin management. You should select the WebXR export. And if you want it to also work in the editor, you need to add the plugin provider that supports your desktop device. So I set it here to Oculus. You can add the Windows Mixed Reality, and I know that now Valve also has a Steam VR plugin, and there's an OpenXR plugin now. So you can use those in the editor, and the WebXR export will know to work with them. There are some settings to set in WebXR, as it's both VR and AR settings. WebXR supports both VR and AR, so you would want to add to set maybe some other definitions for VR and for AR. One of the settings is a reference space, which the space here is hiding behind the dropdown. But the different kinds of spaces we have are local, which the device is the root this is made for a sitting. If you want a sitting experience, so you should set local. And if you want a standing environment experience, you should set it to local floor, which will make the center of the center of the world as your device minus the floor, so you will be in a standing position. And there's a bounded floor, which is similar to local floor, but it's based on the guardian system of the device, and it will put you in the center of the guardian. And there's unbounded, it's for devices that don't have guardian, and it's especially for experiences that should be large scale, because in large scale the devices may change the world root position. So unbounded is a specific reference space for this case, but most of the time you would want to use a local floor or local. Viewer space, it's if you are with a handheld device like a mobile phone, it's like the space of the screen. It's like in Unity you have the mouse and mouse position, so it's similar to that, or touch position. And there are optional features. VR don't have any optional features that Unity supports right now, but for AR, VR do have some optional features. VR have the hand tracking in Oculus. Oculus Quest supports hand tracking, so you can use this, but in our demo, we won't use the hand API. And AR settings, you have heat test and hand tracking. There's hand tracking on HoloLens. Heat test, it's like, you know, like in regular AR, when you touch the screen and it's fire a ray to the world, and it will give you a heat position in the real world with coordinates of the virtual world. I hope it's understandable. In the WebXR, the heat test has lots of capabilities. You can set it from different position on the screen and stuff like that. Currently in Unity, in WebXR Export, we use only one case of heat test, which fire a ray from the center of the screen. So you will be able to position your experience in the world, but you can't click on different parts of the screen and fire a ray from them. Just so you will know. That's it for the settings. Some settings for experiences in WebXR and Unity, as Unity doesn't support I now read the comment in the chat, and see the imagining a Quest user in a field.
It's like you have Julie Andrews talking about The Sound of Music with a headset on and virtual cows flying across the sky.
Oh my God.
My imagination's great. Apologies for the interruption. Please continue.
I needed it. Okay, so lost one question. No, no, but, I see lots of users suing the developer after an unfortunate accident. So as it's running on WebGL and it's not officially supported by Unity, and some of the users will run it on desktop, but some of the users will run it on mobile devices. Optimization and performance, it's something that is really necessary. So no image processing, no shadows, or no real-time shadows. You can use baked shadows. You can use the old blob shadows and projection shadows, but don't use the Unity real-time shadow system. So in the quality settings, make sure that to disable shadows on the WebGL platform. You might want to optimize some other stuff. Also draw calls, it's really important. In this scene, I used some free assets, and if we will see in the frame debugger, I have like too many draw calls here. It's not, if I click play, it won't be almost 200, it will be more like 50. But because we use two cameras and it's two views, so it's double the number, the number that you will see in the editor. On Oculus Quest, for example, I don't know how it is in the Oculus Quest 2, but in Oculus Quest 1, you would like to have around maximum 50 draw calls for both eyes. So you should really optimize your scenes. Or just pay attention that you use some assets that can be batched together. And let's follow what we have in the scene. So in the scene, we have the WebXR camera set, which comes with the WebXR interactions pack. And in it, we have the WebXR manager and the WebXR camera set. We have controllers, hand left and right. In each controller, we have the WebXR controller, which set the position, the pose of the controller. This is for WebXR. In the editor or on other platforms, we still use the track pose driver from the XR plugin system. And the WebXR interactions also adds controller interaction, which is a sample that shows how to use different aspects of the WebXR controller. Like it takes from the get button and get axis and get button up and down. Get the input profile. So if you added the input profiles package to your project, it will try to get the model of your controller. And if you enabled the ENDS API, so on supported devices like the Oculus Quest, if you will put aside your controllers, and you will set on enable the hands flag on the Oculus browser. It's under about flags or something like that in Oculus browser. It's still not, you know, published to all the users. So you need the users specifically need to enable it. But if you enable it and you enable the ENS API and you use this controller, it will show, it will load some it will load the hand joints. If I'll show a video here. So I have a video of the hands. This is a model from the sample scene, but I put the controllers on the side and we can see the cubes that represent the joints of the hand. So it's really nice. And back to Unity. So this was the hands and the controllers. Now the cameras, we have WebXR camera, and because there's no official support of Unity, we have the camera main, which uses, we use it for the flat screen mode in WebXR before you enter the WebXR mode. And in the editor and on other platforms, this is the camera that actually moves with the XR plugin. So the Oculus plugin still uses the camera main here. You can see that it has its own track pose driver. We have cameras for VR mode. Well, just the simple settings of the cameras. And we have cameras for AR mode, which there we set the clear flags of the camera to don't clear. So you will be able to see the image from the camera, from the webcam of the device. And you can set some culling masks. Like in the sample, in the desert sample scene, we remove the desert models using the culling mask, and we set a special layer to the models there. And the camera, the WebXR camera has some APIs, so you could you will be able to get the local rotation of the camera and the local position of the current cameras because we're switching between the cameras, so it will be more simple to the developer to get some data about them. In this specific demo, I don't see the chat right now. Back to the chat. So in this specific demo, I added some components that interacts with the WebXR API. One of them is this follow head. Unity something. So as you can see, I just referenced the WebXR camera, and each update I get local position, local rotation, And that's it. In it, we have also follow hand to follow the controllers. And we have this robot by Kenny. We have this character. And on it, we added some look at where we look at at the head again, getting a target, doing some look at, and the same with the hands. So when we move the controllers, it will say hello to us and will look at us and stuff like that. So this is one way to use the WebXR camera API. Some other stuff in this demo, there's the controller camera. This used for the UI, the VR UI system. We put a camera, a disabled camera, so the canvas will recognize it. In the canvas, we set the event camera as the controller camera, and we have here a cylinder to show we have a cylinder to show how it's done, like the direction. And we have the teleporter. So the teleporter is from the Git package. I can show right now the package's manifest. We have here the VR teleporter, the WebXR input, WebXR interaction. So the teleporter is from the Git. You can see all in the project. And we have some, we have the interactables. And, oh, no, I still didn't finish with the follower. There's the event system that connects with the camera. It's the controller input module. It's based on an old script, the old gaze input module by Peter Koch. There's the source of the gaze input module in this link. All in the repository, in the sample repository, so you can check it out. And it has the hit points, so you will see where are you pointing at with your device. And we have the teleporter, which is the WebXR teleporter component on it. You can set it to flat if you want it to be based on your camera view or to controller, if you want it to based on a specific controller. In the WebXR teleported, you will want to set the body transform, which is the, you want it to set it to the WebXR camera set, as it tells him you are teleporting this game object, this entire hierarchy. And you can exclude some layers. So I excluded a layer of interactables, which are the pizza and the cake. The pizza and the cake also has a tag interactable. The controller interaction looks for objects that are tagged as interactable, And then he knows to grab them. And on the those interactables, we also has a mouse drag object, which lets you drag them on a flat screen before you enter the WebXR mode. And let's see. Yeah, I think we got everything. Now we have the WebGL templates. So before building to WebXR, you need the special templates. You can't use the default Unity WebGL templates. So you have here, under window, you have WebXR and copy WebGL templates. It will copy supported WebGL templates to your project. If you are using Unity 2019, you want to use WebXR or WebXR full view. And if you are using Unity 2020, you will want to use WebXR 2020 or WebXR full view 2020, as Unity changed some APIs between 2019 and 2000.
Yeah, they changed a lot of things. Little things that make a big difference with VR and AR.
Yeah, and so because contrary to other folders like the editor folder or the streaming assets folder or plugins folder, we can't use like WebGL templates in a subfolder. So we can't put these WebGL templates in the plugin folder. We have to put it under assets WebGL templates. yes. okay, so we're going to the build settings, player settings, and we want to set resolution and presentations. I'm usually make sure to set the default width and height to some kind of a small width and height, because most of the people are now with screens with high resolution, and the developers are in with high resolution, and they don't pay attention that they actually, if you open it with a device with a smaller resolution, you see only part of the WebGL screen. So I set it to something smaller for other devices. Or you can use the WebXR full view, which spread the content of the WebGL on the entire page. So here we use the WebXR template. On publish settings, this is important. If you're going to use WebXR in a game jam, you probably would want to use itch.io. That now supports WebXR. They added it recently. And other sites that you can upload there, it's there's glitch.com. And if you are already using GitHub and it's open source, you can use GitHub pages. So in this repository, I'm using GitHub pages to share the experience. And each server has other settings for compressions. So each IO will know to work with a compressions format of GZIP. But GitHub pages or glitch, they need you to disable the compression format. If you will use GZIP, the experience won't work and it will give you some strange error that won't tell you, oh, it's because you used GZIP. So you should know when to disable and when you to use gzip. And we want to build the project. Don't use build and run, because Unity will use its own server, which is an HTTP server, and your experience might won't work. So I'm using a local server. There's Node.js. You can install something called HTTP server, and it's a easy to use command line tool that can also run HTTPS server. There's lots of details here, how to make the certificate to enable SSL and stuff like that. And something that I want to show here. You can edit those templates. So in our example, we use only VR. So we want to remove the AR button. So you can look in it, the HTML page of the template, and remove the all the stuff that reference the AR button. So your users won't accidentally click on AR. And I think it's been a long talk, so I won't go into more details, but let's see, I do want to show the desert scene. Just for general knowledge. In the desert scene, we can see the scene heat test. This object let you position your scene based on a heat test in the real world when you are in AR mode. And that's it. Do we have some questions?
Looks like you had one, Chris.
Yeah, I was just curious. The web templates you use for WebXR builds, do they have sort of custom JavaScript libraries that you include with those templates in order to make it work? Or is that part of just the export process from Unity that you build that in somehow with magic?
Okay, so until one version ago, it's in Hebrew, sorry. So until one version ago of the WebXR export, there were also some custom JavaScript files with the template, but now it's only the index.html, which we added it some custom JavaScript only for the buttons. Okay, there's event listeners that listens to the AR button, but yeah, you can. There is some importance to the hierarchy of the web page, like the container, how the container of the Unity WebGL canvas is defined and stuff like that. So if you want to use WebXR export with your own custom template, it will be better to start with this WebGL template. We also have here, like, we override the compatibility check for mobile. It's relevant for 2019, but in 2020 they don't check for mobile, so there's no reason to the compatibility check in 2020. I hope it answered the question.
I was going to ask one more question with the WebXR exports. You mentioned reducing the draw calls. Are there any specific gotchas that you would recommend avoiding? Oh, shadows you said also should be turned off. Were there any other gotchas you would recommend people look out for?
Nothing not usual, you know. When you're doing some optimization work, you should do the general optimization work stuff. There are specific tools for checking in WebGL, for debugging in WebGL. Like there's something called Spectre.js. So there's this tool that lets you have something similar to Unity's frame debugger, but on the web page. And even if you didn't edit to your template while building the project, because it's on the web and you can open developer console, so you can enter any WebGL page and paste a few lines of JavaScript, and it will let you debug the WebGL canvas.
That's pretty incredible. Like
you can see it. Yeah.
These tools are very useful.
Yeah, I should have known about this a few months ago, actually.
Oh, you did some stuff with WebGL?
Yeah, I've worked on a few projects using 3JS mostly. But sometimes debugging some stuff like that would have been useful rather than just console log. She's my friend.
Yeah. But the Spectre.js don't work when you are in WebXR mode. So only when you are in the flat mode. Anything else? Well, so thank you.
Thank you.
It was fun. I can put some links in the chat.
Feel free to drop all of those links into chat. Those are super resources for everybody.
Yeah, that was the sample. I really recommend the WebXR Discord, as there's a very lively community there. If you heard about Tilt Brush, that they just open sourced Tilbrush, Google open source Tilbrush. So one of the members of the community there took the source code of Tilbrush and it's Unity, and he is now trying to run it in WebXR using WebXR Export. So
that's pretty epic.
Yeah,
I already had one person on Slack today saying, "Hey, did you hear the open source tilt brush? Can we include this in our project?" I'm like, "We have 2 weeks, maybe."
Just copying the code.
Yeah,
how hard can it be?
It'd be fine. Everything's fine.
Yeah, Unity 2018. At least it was the LTS. Nice. Yeah, and they use the old Steam VR package there, so fun.
Awesome. Okay, do we have any more questions from the audience? Please feel free to type them in to Twitch chat. And whilst you think of your questions, we do have some licenses for JetBrains to give away. Graham, do you want to explain?
Sure, yeah. So we have three licenses to give away, and we've tried asking like questions in the past, they're like trivia questions, and it's sort of like a mixed bag of how useful that is. So here's a super easy one. What is the, so if you type this in Twitch chat, the first three people to type it will get a key. So what is the theme for this year's Global Game Jam? And while people are thinking about that, JetBrains is a company that makes IDEs, developer tools that help programmers mainly. They make Rider, which is an awesome C# IDE for Unity. So it's definitely cool. You get a free year of it, which is like a whole bunch of money. So it's a pretty good deal. Okay, we have three people here.
We have three winners.
Snoopicious, JC Gray 2, and Baron Velociraptor. Oh my God, that name is amazing. I will DM you on Twitch and get your email and send you the keys.
That sounds like a good thing to do.
Cool.
Okay. So yes, you guys want to hold on for a second and ask Graham messages each of you, or you can also message this account, the Boston Unity Group account. Just ping me quickly with your email addresses, and we will get you those license keys. Highly recommend Rider as an editor for Unity projects. It's great.
Cool.
So is this your game on video? Yeah.
Yes. And it's with the hands API.
Nice.
You can see the hands here.
Yeah, that works.
When it works.
When it's not embedded in a web page or on a screen that's being broadcast and shared and all the layers. That's awesome.
That's really cool.
Okay.
Well, I can stop sharing the screen.
All right. Let's see. We got our three winners. I haven't seen the messages come in. I don't know if that worked. Oh, yep. Got that one. Got JC Gray. Thank you, JC Gray. Graham, have you heard from Baron Velociraptor yet?
I haven't.
Snoopicus, please message us soon. Okay. All right, guys.
So you guys are going to participate in this global game jam?
Mm-hmm. I'm not. No, not this year.
Yeah, me neither.
I wish. Every year I say I wish I would love to do it, but this year now I got a lot on.
Yeah, our game is coming out in a couple of weeks, so
oh,
a little tight.
Congrats.
Thank you. Yeah. Let's see.
All right, Snoopicus, I sent you a message from my account, so hopefully you'll be able to message us back.
Snoopicus says.
All right, thank you very much, Oren, for joining us tonight. I know it's incredibly late for
you right now.
You're probably going to go and collapse because it's like 1 a.m., 1:15 a.m.
Yeah, but my schedule of sleeping is not really related to real world hours and to the sun, so and all the adrenaline after the talk, so I guess it will be a long night.
that's fine.
So it's okay. I had really lots of fun here, and
that's great. Thank you very much.
Thanks for coming to knock. Come along and showing us this stuff. It's really cool.
Thanks.
Yeah, that was great. Thank you. And we'll be back next month. I can't remember which presentation comes up next.
Adam DeGrandis. Some crazy art stuff from all the way from Maine.
From distant shores of Maine.
More info will be coming. But
excellent. Adam. All right. That's great. Thank you very much. And we will see you all next month.
Bye, everybody.